speaker is going to talk to testing issues. Dr. Peg Luksik is a Pennsylvania teacher with over 35 years experience in both special education and elementary school education. She founded a program to assist low-income single mothers complete their education, which was recognized by President Reagan and named as a national point of light by President George Bush. Please welcome Dr. Luksik.
To the introduction, I am a teacher with over 35 years experience. I also worked for the United States Department of Education for a number of years, and my job was to review and evaluate education reform initiatives. So when grants like Race to the Top and the State Fiscal Stabilization Fund were written and sent to the federal government, I was one of the people who got them and read them and said, you get money, you don't get money. And when I started opposing them in the 90s, in a former incarnation of this called outcome-based education, they did not need my services anymore because I wasn't part of the agenda. I do want to begin by just giving you, I'm going to feed you through a fire hose in the next 45 minutes, and so I can move more quickly. I'm not going to do a PowerPoint. However, I do want to make you know that over on the table there are, what I'm going to talk to you about is available in a CD because people always ask, where you can actually see the research I'm going to cite, you can download it, you can look at it. There's also one called Should Our Children Be Standardized? This talks about what happens when you attempt to set one achievement standard for all the children, and it's how that affects education. This one also includes the Advanced Placement U.S. History, the APUSH, with an analysis of what it does teach versus what we used to teach. So they're available over on the side. There's also, I write a weekly blog, and you can pick up one of the editions. The website where you can get it, and it's free, is just right on the top. So do pick it up, and then you can sign up and be part of the conversation for free. We're going to be talking about testing issues today. I'm not going to talk about the content of the test so much as about the structure of the test. When I was in grad school, part of my fellowship was to actually work in the university testing clinic, so I was one of the folks who, when they came in for special ed to diagnose children and give all the tests, I was one of the folks who trained people. I gave them and then trained people in how to do them. Testing is actually a very strict construct, and when they use the words valid and reliable, those words mean something. Now, when we talk about medicine, we understand that. When we talk about manufacturing, we understand that. For example, in medicine, can a doctor stand up and say, I've developed a cure for cancer, and I've done all my own field testing, and you know what, the results were wonderful. Let me tell you how well I did, and now I want to put it on the market. Would you buy that medicine? No. But in education, your State Department of Education is mandating the standards, overseeing the curriculum, writing the test, administering the test, setting the standards for passing, scoring the test, and then telling you how well they did. If you buy that, you should buy that doctor's cancer medicine, because it's exactly the same. Valid and reliable mean something. So let's walk through what they mean. Valid. I am testing what I say I'm testing and nothing else. So if I say this is a multiplication test, you wouldn't expect me to say spell cat, right? But there's more to it than just the content of the test. Now, I have a sister, she's a nurse, and for a number of years she worked for a pharmaceutical company, and she worked in the lab that did when they test pharmaceuticals. And this is how it works. If you want to be a volunteer, you go in and they give you probably one of the most complete physicals you've ever had in your whole life. And if you don't match the profile, you do not get to participate in the test. For example, my husband and I have been married for a long time. My standing blood pressure is 90 over 60. Doctors go, are you pregnant? Are you okay? Did you want to sit down? That's my normal number. My husband fights with medication to be the top, whatever you would call normal, for his age and weight. neither of us would qualify for a test of blood pressure medicine because neither of us are normal walking in or fit the we wouldn't fit the same parameters. So when they test medication or a pharmaceutical device, the first thing they do is give you a complete physical, and if you don't fit the exact profile, you don't get to take the test because they want to know that there's no extra factors changing the results. The second thing they do is they say you must come in anywhere from 72 hours to 1 week early, and then you live in the testing facility. Why do they do that? So they're sure you don't show up the morning of the test having, you know, had about 17 beers last night. Or you got 8 hours of sleep. Or you had what we wanted you to have for supper. So you're neither malnourished or you had 16 pieces of cake, and so there's all kind of extra sugar in your blood. They want to control everything. So they make you stay in the facility so that everything is the same except the drug or the pharmaceutical device that they are using you to test. Because the volunteer, the person, is an extraneous factor. Now let's move back to education. So we give these tests and we say they're high stakes, and our little bunchkins walk into the classroom. Maybe they're sick. They don't know to tell you. When we were kids, one of my sisters, the school we went to gave exams in January and in, at the end of the year, you know. And so in January, my sister flunked them all. She was seven. And the nun in charge, the principal, called my mother and said, "Miss McKenna, I honestly don't know what happened. I mean, we thought she was learning everything. We need to schedule an appointment to talk about this." And they scheduled an appointment for 2 days later. And in the day in the middle, my mother called and said, "Never mind, she broke out in the measles last night." So she was sick when she took the test, but didn't know. Sometimes something happened at home. Your dog died last night. I was in New York, in Rochester, and a teacher actually stood up and talked about a six-year-old whose mother was killed on the front porch of her home. And you want her to take a test? Perhaps there's upheaval. The family's in the middle of a divorce. Perhaps there was something that happened in the neighborhood. You know, there was a fire up the street or somebody was sick in the ambulance. You know, when an ambulance with lights, no child sleeps, they're all at the window. Perhaps they didn't get breakfast that morning. Any one of those things will change the results of the test. The problem is, nobody knows which children they are. So when you look at 1,000 test results, you don't know if this one's result is because she was sick or because your dog died. You don't have any idea. In any given large testing population, on average about 10% of the children will have one of those interfering factors, which means the test result doesn't mean anything. Because it's not an evaluation of how they did. What you're really measuring is whether they were sick or something happened to them. However, as the socioeconomic status of the children goes down, that percentage goes up. Because children from lower economic backgrounds are more likely to have had family upheaval, not enough rest, poor nutrition, something happened in their neighborhood, which means the tests on their face are discriminatory. Because children from poorer backgrounds will do worse, not because of their academic performance or knowledge, but because something got in the way. And yet we are using those tests to determine promotion or graduation or to evaluate teachers. It is not valid on the surface. Now, I was in Tennessee testifying, and one of the legislators said, "So you want to control every child?" I said, "Well, no, absolutely not. That would be ridiculous, and you couldn't anyway." What I'm telling you is you're trying to make object decisions on data that is not validly objective, which is why those of you who are over 35 or so will remember when you took Stanford or the Iowa or the California or the Metropolitan, they were four big achievement tests. They didn't count toward promotion or graduation. They were a way for the system to say, outside of our scope, how are you doing? But the results were really wonky for you as an individual. You shouldn't sit in the front, I use those examples all the time. You just, okay. were really wonky for you as an individual, then the school looked at it and said they work or they don't. That's why, do you remember when you were in high school? How many times you were down to take the SAT? More than once. You didn't take it once, and if you didn't do well. Oh, well, too bad for you. You can go back and take it again. In fact, the National Research Council, which is a federally funded think tank, said educators have always known that these kinds of tests are not accurate measures of how a child does. Maybe they are, but since we don't know for any given child, you can't count it that way. And yet these assessments do. They fly in the face of what we already know. They're not valid on their face. Now let's take the next step. It's called construct validity, meaning I test what I say I'm going to test. That the content of the test is actually what I want it to be. And now let's look at the math assessments in state after state after state and in the park tests. And it's called constructed response assessment. The child takes a math test. In the math test, there are several mathematical constructs they have to do. And then they're told to write about their answer. Why did you do what you did? Explain to me how you did this or why you did this. They are graded on how well they write about it. So in the examples that are given, and I've pulled them from a number of states and actually stood in front of state legislatures with them, they can do, we'll say there's four sections. First section is do this problem, they do it right. Second section is do this problem, they do it right. Third section is graph it, they do it correctly. Fourth section is write about it, and the child writes one sentence. And they only can get three of the 4 points because they didn't write enough. Now, that's not a math test. That's a writing test. But you're going to get a math grade. How does that work for real? The first group that has trouble with that is boys. If you ask a little girl to write an essay, she will cover the front of the page and the back of the page. She'll probably tell you what she had for breakfast. She'll put little hearts over the notes. If you ask a boy, especially a mathematically intense young man, I have 6 children. They're all girls except for 5 of them. Three of my sons are engineers. If you ask any of my engineering sons, why did you do the math the way that you did it? They would say, because that's the way it worked. And what they wouldn't write but would be thinking is, you dummy. That's what it's for. It worked. It's not with you. Who else has a problem? ESL kids. Kids who are struggling to learn English. Who maybe understood the math perfectly, but couldn't construct a sentence. Kids with learning disabilities. LD kids. Learning disabilities is a really odd kind of exceptionality because it can be very subject specific. So you have kids that are whizzes in math, but they're dyslexic in reading, or vice versa. So that an LD kid can do really, really well in math, but when he tries to write letters, B and D look like the same letter to that little one. Or the words mush around on the page. Some of them report that the letters swim. So they could do the math, but they can't write about it. That's not a math deficiency. It's a language deficiency. Except we called this test math, didn't we? Who else? Kids from lower socioeconomic backgrounds who maybe don't communicate in standard English at home, who are struggling to be able to move into standard English. They're going to get a lower math score. But when you get a lower math score, you get put in math remediation, which means you're going to do that math again. Now, let me show you how that progresses. The U.S. Department of Education in 1999 did a study, the document was called Answers in the Toolbox, and what they found was that if a child gets beyond Algebra 2 in high school, they more than double their odds of attaining a bachelor's degree in college, if that's where they choose to go. That study became part of a meta-analysis done by Auburn University in 2004. A meta-analysis is where researchers, instead of doing a study, they read all the studies that are done, put it together to see if there are trends, can we figure it out? And these are usually 10 years. Auburn did a 25-year meta. They looked at 25 years' worth of research and published it in 2004. And what they found was that if a child gets to calculus in high school, they are 28 times. I did not say 28%. I said 28 times. That's 2,800. Percent more likely not just to attain a bachelor's degree but to be a high achiever in college, regardless of their race, of their socioeconomic status, of the kind of high school they went to, or of the major that they took. Because the skills of higher math, thinking in a straight line, solving problems, persevering, translate to every other major. Now, does that mean every child should take calculus? Of course not. Does that mean every child should go to college? Of course not. But does it mean that we should be setting educational policy that is designed to give every child as much chance as possible to get to calculus if they're able, because it opens doors of opportunity everywhere? Yes, it does mean that. Common Core does the opposite. So Common Core, Trevor Packer, the senior vice president of the College Board, actually addressed the American Association of School Superintendents in 2013 and said Common Core slows the math progression down. Calculus is not part of the Common Core progression. The National Center for Education and the Economy said, published a document called What Does It Mean to Be College and Work Ready? Mark Tucker is the chairman of that. He's been involved forever. And what that document said was getting ready to go to a community college, Algebra 1, by the end of your sophomore year in high school. Because it said, since most community colleges start with Algebra 1, you don't need Algebra 2 to go to college and take Algebra 1. And if you don't have a career, if you're not slotted for a career that will contain Algebra 2 or more, it's a waste to teach it to you. Those are their words, not mine. So, calculus is a door to success. Common Core says, we're not going to get there. Now we put kids in math tests that are high stakes, that test writing, but call it math, and take children who most need that math door, especially kids who have issues, and we say to them, because you didn't write as well, we're going to put you in math remediation, which means we're going to slow that progression down even more. So we've moved them farther away from the opportunity to be successful in college. Isn't it interesting that the Department of Education in 2014 does not know what it did know in 1999? Or is the goal of Common Core something different? When you look at how the testing is constructed, the goals begin to surface. Now, when we put the children in remediation, well, where do you get the time? New York City Public Schools reported last year that kids were being put in up to 3 hours of remediation if they didn't pass the test. Well, that 3 hours was coming from something else, art, music, computer, foreign language. And yet, for kids in a test that didn't test correctly, they're being remediated in a subject they already know, because they can already do the math. Now they're bored out of their heads and ready to shut off the system. Okay? Validity. It's called criteria. How does this test compare, criteria validity, how does this test compare with other measurements of the same thing? You know, most of us get on the bathroom scale every morning with some trepidation, and we get on and it says 120.
Excuse me, Peg, I think your battery died.
Okay.
I'm hoping that's what it is.
I'll just talk about it. There you go. Oh, there you go.
Test.
No, it's not going to work well in the cameras.
Oh, you can't hear it on the...
Yeah, right. I don't want to hear it either.
We can play Jeopardy music.
Yeah.
There we go.
Okay, so every morning you get on your bathroom scale, and you look down and it says 120, and you feel really, really good about yourself. Isn't this terrific? Look at me, I'm doing such a good job. And then you go to the doctor for your physical and you step on his scale. And it says something a little different. That means your bathroom scale wasn't valid, because you know the doctor's scale is, because it uses those awful little weights that means it's got to be right. Your scale didn't match another measurement. Your scale wasn't valid. It's reliable, said the same thing every time, but it wasn't valid. It didn't give you accurate information. When we look at the tests of the Common Core, what we find is they don't match other tests. So in New York, in this past year, the children did not do well in the 8th grade math test. But when those same children in the same year took the test, the New York Algebra 1 Regents exam, 58% of the kids that failed the state assessment achieved mastery in the Algebra Regents. Well, either you can do it or you can't do it. Once, some children are going to test differently because, remember, we looked at the first section. But 58% of them? I find that impossible to believe. When we look at the state assessments, No Child Left Behind said every state had to have children be advanced, proficient, or basic. They used state assessments to determine it, and that was this, but the state could set the definition of proficient wherever they wanted, and they could determine proficient to be wherever they wanted. In 2010, the National Center for Education Statistics, 2008, I'm sorry, the National Center for Education Statistics took the NAEP, the National Assessment, and made a chart. Here's what proficient means in the NAEP. Here's what basic, which is like C minus, means in the NAEP. This is failing. And then they took where every single state defined proficient, and they put it against that measurement scale. Not one single state defined proficient in the same place that the NAEP did. Not one. Only 8 states defined proficient in the achievement level that the NAEP would call basic. And 42 states defined proficient below what was even basic in the NAEP. But if the tests are valid, proficient should basically mean the same thing everywhere. Either you can do 8th grade reading or you can't do 8th grade reading. And while for any individual child those results are not valid, it is not possible that every child in the 8th grade class in the state of Idaho had a bad day on the same day. So when you look at a large group, you should see some connection. But in fact, there was none. Nobody matched the NAEP. Nobody was as high as the NAEP. In 2010, colleges came out and said 60% of the children who are entering our universities need remediation. But those kids were being tested as proficient. So are you on grade level? Can you do college level math or can't you do college level math? I'm from the state of Pennsylvania. I went back into our websites and started looking at, okay, well, I'm a little concerned about this. What did you define as proficient? Pennsylvania's Algebra 1 test, which you do not have to pass until the 11th grade, has 6 different modules in it. In the very first module, there were 9 possible points. If you got 3 of them, you passed. That's a 33%. I don't know any parent on the planet who, when their child would come home with a 33%, would say, "Congratulations, honey, you're proficient." We would use other words. The highest you had to get was a 60%. That's not proficient either. As I look across, and when I travel from state to state, I pull their, it's called a cut score. You know, like in football, you made the cut or you didn't. You made proficient or you didn't. And what you find is that the average range in the states for proficient is anywhere from 50 to 70%. In different subjects, it will drop lower. Every now and again, you'll see it get a little higher. Where is it higher? 50 to 70% would not be what I would call proficient. But when the goal is proficient, and the test can move the bar for proficient up and down, and there's punishments if you don't make the line, what are they going to do? They're going to move the bar down. Let me show you. Stand up. My goal wire up there, exercise is good. Excellent thing. Okay, this is vocal performance. When you can meet my standard, you can sit down.
Yep.
You cannot sit down until you meet my standard. Are you ready? Luciano Pavarotti. Anybody who can sing like Pavarotti, considered one of the greatest tenors of the 20th century, can sit down. Soloist, oh, congratulations. Soloist with the New York Met. Chorus member with the New York Met. Soloist with the Regional Symphony. Chorus member with the Regional Symphony. Soloist with your church choir. sings in your church choir, sings in the shower and enjoys it, band clarinet tune in a bucket, can't find the bucket. In vocal performance, you are required to have 100% of the children meet the standard for proficient, but you can set the standard wherever you want. Where are you going to put it? It sings in the shower and enjoys it, because that's where you all sat down. I am a teacher in a classroom. In the Common Core system, there is no reward whatsoever for any child taking one single step past the standard. Where am I going to spend all my time? With Mr. Can't Carry a Tune in a Bucket back there, getting him up to, sings in the shower and enjoys it. What about the child for whom the standard should have been Pavarotti? Well, that child walked into the classroom already able to sing in the shower and enjoy it. So he passed the test before the first day. So the teacher's going to ignore him or use him to teach other children. And in fact, the research shows that when we set a standard like that, the focus of the classroom becomes on the children immediately above the standard and immediately below the standard. The teacher drops Mr. Can't Find the Bucket over there. The teacher will ignore Can't Find the Bucket because that person will never get up to the shower. And I'm trying to cut my losses to get as close as I can to 100%. So the children at the bottom actually decline. The children at the top stagnate. Mm-hmm. What this system does is changes the definition of success in education from enlightening each child to meeting a standard. The standard becomes the goal, not the child. And in fact, that's what the research shows. Children at the bottom get further behind. Children at the top stagnate, and the curriculum narrows to the test. So I was in New York, and a state legislator who used to be a teacher said, yeah, we all knew that every year the Seneca Falls Convention was going to be on the test, so every history teacher taught Seneca Falls. Didn't matter what else you taught, we all taught that because we knew there were going to be this many questions on the test. Because test drives curriculum. For all of us. For all of us. And if I manipulate the standards so that people see success, parents don't question as much. So David Coleman, Common Core architect, moved from Student Achievement Partners. I don't know if you know this about Mr. Coleman. He actually did attempt to get a job teaching in the New York City public school system, and they declined to hire him. So a man who couldn't get a job teaching is now driving education. He moved from Student Achievement Partners to the College Board, and he said he was going to bring the College Board into alignment with the Common Core state standards. And the new SAT test is now being rolled out, and what we're finding is they dropped the essay section. They've eliminated the penalty for guessing. They've changed the vocabulary section because the College Board said, well, we don't need those obscure words since they're not reading literature anymore. We just need the words you need to do your job. And they've dropped whole sections of the math test. Why would they drop sections of the math test? Well, if I slow the math progression down, but the test still tests the higher progression, parents will go, why did my child get a lower score? So if I drop sections of the test, the score will stay high. You know, there's two ways to look like achievement is going up. You can actually raise achievement, or you can lower the definition for success. The SAT has lowered the definition of success. This is not measuring a child against a standard. This is measuring the standard against the children and changing the standard to make it look like the children did well. Which is what the states did in their state assessment. Just like Pennsylvania, 33% was proficient. Now I debated the Pennsylvania Secretary of Education, actually Dr. Stotsky was there, and said that, and she said, well, there were teachers all over, and it's very disingenuous for you to mention that. She didn't deny that they didn't. It's just mean for me to say so. In Tennessee, the Tennessee Department of Education actually made headlines. They got an F in transparency in education reporting, because they said 100% of the children were proficient. When those same children in the same year took the NAEP in the same subject, 27% of them met the bar. That's a little bit of a difference, 100 to 27. So they changed it to say, we'll still report 100, now 35% of them will be proficient. We'll move to that. That's not validity. If my measurement, just like the bathroom scale, if my measurement doesn't match other measurements, my measurement has a problem. The second part of that picture is called reliability. Reliability is, every time I do it, I'm going to get the same result. In education, would be called a test-retest factor. Did you ever watch the Olympics? Did you ever watch the figure skating? Did you ever watch the gymnastics? 9 judges watch the same athlete do the same performance at the same time and give it 9 different scores. It was such a ruckus in the figure skating community that they actually came up with this really convoluted, and they throw out the top score and the bottom score and do all this stuff to try to make it so the scores mean something. But in these assessments, particularly in the English language arts area and in the constructive response math ones, you have folks reading children's responses and then trying to decide if it's a thorough understanding, a good understanding, a partial understanding, a minimal understanding, or no understanding. What's the difference in those adjectives? What's the bar between thorough and good? Good and partial. Partial and minimal. And who decides? I used to judge forensic competitions in my community. You know, when the kids would all join the forensics club and there would be 2 of us in every little session. And we graded on a 1 to 7 scale. And I was kind of a mark man when I graded. So, if the children came in and they gave their speech, but they gave their speech, so the end of every sentence went down with this. And then they started to talk, you couldn't hear them. And then they did this and you couldn't hear what they said at the end. Because that's how children often talk. They swallow the end of their sentence. And forensics is about actually learning to make a public presentation. So I would grade them down for that. And then give them a big explanation with suggestions on how to fix it. And some children, when they give a speech, they are really sing-songy in how they presented it, and they want to hold this, and they look at the audience. I would grade down for that too. But in one of the sessions that I was with, the woman sitting beside me gave every single child the highest grade for everything. And I looked at her and said, you know, this was a competition. And she said, well, yes, but I want them all to feel really good about themselves. They wanted to get up and talk, and I don't want anybody to feel bad. And I said, but then they don't learn anything. This is an educational activity. So they got a 3 or 4 from me, and a 7 from her. We were in the same room watching the same child doing the same thing. Now your children take these assessments, and they go to folks who sometimes, some of the departments of education, you've seen advertisements where they pay a little bit more than minimum wage, and you get a couple of days training, and then you come and sit, and they give them this rubric and say, okay, you're going to read 1,000 responses. Fit them in. Somehow. How do you know if your child got Miss Martinette or Miss Lucy Goosey as the grader? Any teacher who's ever done this for any length of time will tell you that when you give essay questions, the person who was graded first isn't graded the same as the person who was graded last. Because you're tired. And if you've had a glass of wine in there, if they all do well, you get nicer. If they all do poorly, you get a little more irritated as you go. But in a regular classroom, a kid can walk up and say, her paper, and you can have a conversation. But these tests, you don't know who your grader is. There's no recourse. The scores are final. And teacher evaluation and student promotion
and graduation
is based on an assessment system that is not reliable at all. And what you hear is, well, see, we want them to be able to do critical thinking. I was in a state legislature testifying, and one of the senators who was there said, he was a physician, and he had just come back from being recertified. When you're certain kinds of physicians, you have to go back and test to be recertified. Some of it's a performance, you know, we actually want to see you do whatever you're doing, and the rest of it is a written test. And so I looked at him and said, so how many essay questions were on your test? And he said, none. Right, is that because doctors can't think critically? No. It's because when it's a multiple choice, it's either right or wrong, and so it's a valid assessment. Human judgment, by definition, is subjective. You can't help it. handwriting is hard to read, on average you'll give a lower grade than if the handwriting is easy to read, especially if it's at the very end of the day when you're tired. If you don't like the topic, if you don't like what the kid wrote, you're going to be harder than if you do. They tell them, don't worry about grammatical biases. And actually the scoring rubric in New York says, if the syntax, spelling, and grammar errors do not affect readability, don't grade them. So in your head, I want you to think this. The letter B, the number 4. The letter U, the number 8. What did I just say? That didn't affect readability, did it? So I shouldn't grade down for that. Well, then what do you grade on? You grade on close reading of the text. In New York, the scoring rubrics, I could actually get my fingers on them. Last year, the child read a story about Frederick Douglass and talked about how he learned to read and how his mistress began by teaching him to read, but her husband said, no, this is a slave and you need to treat this individual as a brute. And the story actually documents her descent into depravity. How she started out as this wonderful woman and being a slave owner destroyed her. And Mr. Douglass learned to read another way. And the point was that slavery destroys everybody. The child who wrote the story said his mistress was a nice lady and quoted from the story the phrases from when he first met her and got all the points. That's not critical thinking. They misquoted. So when we look at the scoring, we're seeing, well, they're not scoring grammar, they're not scoring spelling. The Park test says they can use a spell checker when they take the test. And we're not really scoring actual comprehension in the rubrics by the states themselves. So it's purely subjective scoring. So when we look at the tests, there's no way that you can say that these tests mean anything. And yet we're basing decisions about people's futures on tests that are flawed at their face. The last piece is the independent piece, and we talked a little bit about that at the beginning. You remember the State Department of Education. Do you know in medicine, the National Institute of Health actually has standards for ethical guidelines? If you are involved in any way in the thing being tested, you're not allowed to be part of the clinical trial evaluating it. Even if you're doing, this is trial A, and your stuff is in trial B, nope, because your judgment will be colored. If you have a relative, if you have a financial interest, all of that has to come out. Most states and the federal government say nonprofits who collect money every year have to have an independent audit by a certified public accountant, somebody who actually knows what they're doing, who is not in any way involved with your nonprofit. They can't be your bookkeeper, they can't be your treasurer, they can't sit on your board, they can't be related, so that somebody's actually tracking the money. But yet in education, we don't do any of that. Because the Department of Education has this little closed system. And in some states, they're now doing the scoring after the fact. In New Jersey, they set their scores after the raw data was in. In Georgia, they set their scores. They brought the people together and said, okay, these are the scores. Now, if you put proficiency here, this many children pass. If you put it here, this many children pass. If you put it here, this, where would you like to put it? But you already know how many children will meet it. So in New York, they predicted that with these new assessments, only 37% of the children would pass. And I know you'll be shocked. Shocked to know that that was correct. But they set the standard after the data was in. And the Pearson Company, who was the contractor to give the test, was also the entity that brought the 95 people in to set the scoring. And they told those teachers and educators, here's where the standard will be. Common Core isn't just flawed in what they teach our children. It's flawed in how they test our children. It makes it so that the results can match what the departments of education want them to match. I know you're going to hear about workforce development. If I can manipulate where you succeed and where you fail, I can be sure that you are going to go into the workforce place that I have chosen for you. And the Common Core assessment system allows that manipulation to occur. And it is occurring right in front of us. I get asked all the time, why are you here? So you know the facts. I also get asked, are we going to win? You know, it's really funny. So many women in charge, standing up and fighting back about this. And once I got asked why, and I laughingly said, you know, it's been said that fathers will die for their children. And God love you, gentlemen. That's true. Mothers will kill. There is never going to be a day when the moms and grandmoms of America say, it's okay, you can have our little ones. That's not going to happen. But how fast we win depends on you. The very worst thing you can do is walk out of here today and say, that was awful. That's so terrible. I'm so glad you're here fighting it. Good for you. And I'm going to get home and do what I want to do. It almost doesn't matter what you do. Do something. Make sure you tell friends and families. Put a Stop Common Core sign in your yard. A bumper sticker. A button. Attend. Bring more people to the next seminar so that they know. Stand up at school board meetings. Ask every candidate, where do you stand on this? You know, in New York, a bunch of us got involved with Rob Astorino, who's the guy down there running for governor, and taught this to him. He opted his children out of the test, publicly came out against Common Core, and created a Stop Common Core ballot line in the New York, the way they do voting in New York. He got over 100,000 signatures. So he's on the ballot as a Republican, but he's on the ballot as the Stop Common Core candidate. And that happened because parents and taxpayers and teachers in New York said, we're not going to do nothing. We're going to pound and pound and pound. And it is called the issue in the state. And if you watch the debate that happened in New York, there were four of them. Three of them said, I hate Common Core. And Mr. Cuomo, who's been a Common Core cheerleader, did everything he could to try to pretend that it's not me. No, no, it was the Board of Regents. And I'm doing everything I can against it.
Who did that?
The people did that. In New York. Hardly a bastion of conservative anything. So you can do this. Ronald Reagan once said that we're only ever one generation away from tyranny. We don't pass it in the bloodstream. We have to fight for it. We have to defend it. We have to teach it to our children. And if we don't,
we may be the generation who has to tell our children and our children's children about America that used to be free.
I have no intention of becoming that generation. I want my granddaughter to know the same freedoms that I did. And I came here today to beg you to join me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Peg will be speaking after lunch, so if you had any intention of maybe cutting out early, I would, after that presentation, suggest you hang around. Moving right along, our next speaker is going to cover next No Child Left Behind waiver and Title I. Aaron Tuttle is a truth in American education advocate and co-founder of Hoosiers Against Common Core. She was recognized by Governor Mike Pence as a leader in the passage of legislation in the Indiana General Assembly, which rejected the